Kenya under British rule. A place in the sun for shady people, it was called. A place for younger sons, cashiered officers, remittance men whose families would pay them to keep away from England. They gave rise to the catchphrase, "Are you married or do you live in Kenya?" popular until independence in the 1960s. The heart of settler dissipation in the 1920s and 30s was Happy Valley in the White Highlands. The centre of Happy Valley was the home of Jocelyn Hay, 22nd Earl of Errol, and his Countess Lady Edina, née Sackville. Edina was 8 years older than Joss, and he was her third husband. When they eloped together, his career at the Foreign Office was jeopardised, and it was hinted that they should not attend Ascot. Shady people. They made for Kenya. Joss was 23 years old at the time. He had been sacked from Eton, probably for the usual, though he claimed it was for buying a motorcycle from a Jew. Oh, if you don't know what the usual is, ask any public school friend. In Kenya, Joss and Edina set about farming badly and dissipating successfully. It was said of her that she didn't set out to pinch other women's husbands, but she would pick them up if they were left lying about. It was said of him that he was the one of the great pouncers of his generation, a man who preferred to chase married women and regarded their husbands as an insignificant handicap. They threw weekend parties in Happy Valley, which went on until, ideally, every man had slept with every woman, and everyone had slept with Edina. Cocaine and morphine made the parties go like a dream. The Earl and Countess of Errol were not accepted at Government House. Alistair Trafford was a striking Happy Valley dweller. She was very beautiful, with huge violet eyes, dark hair and creamy skin. She adored animals, and quite liked people for sexual and passionate purposes. Her daughters were merely in the way, and she packed them off to a relative to look after. She shot Raymond de Trafford and herself in a railway compartment in the Gare du Nord when he refused to marry her, survived the injury and a sensational trial, and married him. The marriage lasted a whole 3 months. A still more unpleasant member of the circle was John Carberry. He was appallingly sadistic, torturing animals till he killed them, and once at least indulging in a disgusting thrashing of his naked adolescent daughter Juanita, assisted by her governess and in the presence of his third wife, June. At length Juanita left home, showed her injuries to the police, and took permanent refuge with a sane and respectable uncle. But by the end of the 1930s, Joss Errol started to pull his socks up. After a brief fascist interlude, he began to take a serious interest in serious settler politics. When the war came, he undertook useful duties, moving troops to Eritrea. He seemed to have a great future in the colony. But he still pounced on other people's wives. In November 1940, another shady character returned to Kenya, where he had bought land but never settled in the 1920s. Sir Jock Delvis Broughton was 57. As a captain in the Irish Guards, he contracted a reputation for cowardice in 1914, when sunstroke struck him down just as his regiment left for the front. Brother officers believed he had faked it. He inherited great wealth and squandered it extravagantly. To recoup cash, he engineered a young officer called Hugh Dickinson into helping him with 2 insurance frauds. In the first, pearls that Broughton had bought for £6,000 and insured for £12,000 were stolen from his girlfriend's car by Dickinson, who then returned them to Broughton. After Broughton's death, the insurance company actually recovered them from a tree in which he had hidden them. In the second fraud, Dickinson was blackmailed into cutting out the canvases of 3 paintings from Broughton's ancestral home and destroying them. Broughton's first wife, Vera, left him in 1935. And Broughton took up with the ex-wife of a dance band musician who was 30 years younger than himself. Diana Caldwell was on the edge of aristocratic circles, and after the error of her first short-lived marriage to the bandsman, was never to leave them again. She travelled to Kenya with Broughton and married him en route. A relationship that foundered within 2 months when she first set eyes on Jos Errol. She was strikingly attractive. She had pale blonde hair, ice-blue eyes, and a golden tanned complexion. In normal times, she kept herself exceptionally svelte and slim. But in times of great happiness or great distress, she tended to get fat. Jos Errol was putting on a little weight himself, but the spark between the two of them was instant. His current numera una was away in South Africa, and he and Diana instantly started sleeping together. What about Jock? Well, there was an amazing pact that he had signed at the time of his marriage to Diana. This conceded that, as she was so much younger than he, she might at any time fall in love with a younger man. If this happened, Broughton would let her go gracefully, and he would give her an allowance of £5,000 a year for 7 years after their separation. If this weird document had not survived in the hands of Diana's good friend Hugh Dickinson, to whom she entrusted it for safekeeping, it would absolutely beg a belief. Should Jos and Diana now call on this pact? Jos certainly had no other money to support her. They discussed the matter with Gladys Lady Delamere, Mayor of Nairobi. A former lover of Jos's, she seemed to play Cupid with great benignity, urging them to elope, leaving a note in the pincushion, and indeed she urged them to demand the £5,000 a year. Gladys Delamere was a very peculiar woman. She concurrently left anonymous notes at the club for Broughton, saying, "Do you know that your wife and Lord E have been staying alone at the Carberry's house at Nyeri together?" And, "There's no fool like an old fool. What are you going to do about it?" What Jock Broughton did, after some apparent mental turmoil, was to yield gracefully. On the 21st of January 1941, he consulted his lawyer about divorce and booked a passage to Ceylon. On the 23rd, he invited Errol and Diana, with her closest friend in Kenya, sadist John Carberry's wife, June, to a celebration dinner at the Mutega Club. Errol, thoroughly experienced in the ways of cuckolded husbands, was distinctly surprised. "Jock couldn't have been nicer," he told a friend. "He has agreed to go away. As a matter of fact, he's been so nice it smells bad." Nonetheless, Errol agreed that he would bring Diana home to Broughton's house in Carron after that dinner before 3 a.m. that night, after he and she had gone dancing at the Claremont Club following this bizarre celebration. At the dinner, Broughton proposed a toast to the younger couple. After they had left, he became more understandably irritable and said peevishly to June Carberry that he had no intention of paying them £5,000 a year. But at about 1:30 a.m., he and June went back to his house in Carron and retired to separate bedrooms. Around 2:20, Errol and Diana drove up to the Carron house. Errol's car doors slammed, and the car drove away again. Diana went into June's room and sat on the bed talking to her for half an hour or so. At 3:30, Broughton knocked on June Carberry's door to ask if she was all right. She'd complained of feeling ill earlier that night. Then the house slept. At 3 a.m., Errol's car was found 2.5 miles from the Broughton house, its nose in a ditch, its ignition switched off, but its headlights blazing. At the foot of the passenger seat lay Lord Errol. He had been shot through the head. The police investigation pointed to Broughton, a devious man who seemed far more angered than he let on by the loss of his wife. He was thought to have planned the murder a few days earlier, when he reported the theft from his house of 2 pistols and a cigarette case. The police believed that he had hidden his own pistols and used the Colt 32 to kill Errol. Powder marks on Errol's skin showed that his murderer had used old-fashioned cartridges filled with black gunpowder. Spent cartridges on a nearby farm owned by a close friend of Broughton's showed that somebody in a very small group, including Jock and Diana, had used such cartridges a week earlier in target practice. Police tests showed that it was just possible to climb down the drainpipe from Broughton's window and thus leave the house silently without arousing anyone. If Broughton travelled from Carron in the car with Errol, there was plenty of time for him to walk back and knock on June Carberry's door at 3:30. Broughton lit a large bonfire in a pit the day after the murder, and police recovered a blood-stained golf stocking from the refuse. But the case collapsed in court. Errol's counsel proved that the murder bullet could not have come from a Colt. Quite unquestionably, it had too many lands and the rifling ran the wrong way. And Broughton was unshakable in the box. He had stood by his pact. He was far too old and infirm to go shinning down drainpipes or scurrying over 2 miles at night. Anyway, he'd been too drunk even to remember the knock on June's door, which supplied his best alibi. He never wore golf stockings, and he'd always enjoyed bonfires. He never wished Lord Errol any harm. A white settler jury, probably determined, like all the witnesses, that the natives must not be treated to the spectacle of an aristocrat of the ruling class hanged for murder, found him not guilty. Broughton returned to England a year later in what he hoped might be triumph, but committed suicide in 1942. And the rest of the sorry shower went their own sad ways. Alistair Trafford committed suicide after a hysterectomy in 1941. She asked her friends to hold a cocktail party over her grave. Gladys Delamere died of a stroke in 1943. June Carberry slowly drank and drugged herself to death. Only Diana prospered, marrying first the eccentric recluse Gilbert Colville, who was one of the richest men in Kenya, and finally, and very happily, Gladys Delamere's stepson, Tom, so that Diana, too, became Lady Delamere. So who did kill Lord Errol? For a long time it was believed a woman had done so. There were white pipe clay marks on the back of the car, and these seemed to point to a lady's newly cleaned tropical court shoes. It might have been Alistair Trafford or Gladys Delamere, both unstable former lovers of Errol's who could easily have resented being supplanted by a much younger woman. It might have been Diana herself if, as some people speculated, Broughton had refused to stump up the 5,000 a year, and Joss Errol had then revealed that the money had attracted him more than Diana herself. It might even have been June, possibly on Diana's behalf. Certainly, her unsubstantiated evidence gave the only alibis for Diana and Jock. In 1980, journalist James Fox finally discovered the truth. In that year, he met John Carberry's abused daughter, Juanita, and learned what she had never told anyone else. Jock Broughton, alone among her father's gin-sodden circle, had always been kind to her. The day after the murder, she had been at his house. She saw the bonfire, and she saw burning on it the white pipe-clayed plimsolls he had worn for his long walk home. Broughton confessed to her that he had committed the murder. The police were right all the time.